Just loan to me.
Oh, okay. Well, it is. I think that we will be in a position. We are in a position to assure you, in whatever way is necessary to satisfy.
I think we do need some further addressing.
Okay, and perhaps we'll get an opinion of counsel as to the and put that before you on that score.
Let's just move along a bit here and going down to 8B and 8C, which are both on the checklist as partial. I think the problem there is that the water mains and culverts are not, they don't relate from one page to the next. It's very difficult to follow, and maybe you have somebody who can address that.
Yes, now I want to be certain that we've addressed the previous one, but I would say that question would be for Mr. Levesque on the water mains. And so if you want to, why don't you go ahead and do that, Roland?
Good evening. My name is Roland Levesque. I'm an engineer with Whitman and Howard. And I'd be glad to answer any questions that you had on terms of continuation of the water main or the culverts. Because I thought we pretty much handled that issue on each page by either noting C page 5 of 19 or in typical manner to show continuation.
I think it needs to be all reflected in one place if we can do that. So the drainage is tremendously important on this whole project, and to see where everything does flow visually on a plan.
So you're looking like for one entire plan that reflects
yes.
the whole storm drainage system?
And you've got the hydrants in and so forth, but mm-hmm. The water mains and the culverts are a little vague. And perhaps not enough going over on the next page. You don't have the checklist, but Mr. Boos could perhaps share it with you. The drains need to be better delineated and shown a lot better in this for our purposes of review. There aren't enough showing where everything is draining to, where it's coming from, where it's going to, and that sort of thing. Are there some questions of other board members or comments? I think it would be helpful also, and this goes into another area under 10B, the highway locations and information, if we can show exactly the line going out to Fowler Road, even though you may propose a crash gate and so forth, and we need to see that reflected.
So you're looking for the road design
yes,
from
that,
our site
yes.
to Fowler Road?
It's important to see what the interrelationship is. And under 10C, the easement locations and information, that needs to be more carefully delineated and described.
But okay, I can respond to that and say that our easements, as I understand it, the final language and the final legal documents are prepared in connection with the final plan. There are conditions of the final plan, and those easements will be drawn with great care and defined.
But we need to pin down maybe that 15-foot floating easement.
Oh, yes. All right. Well, we will have language. If that language, we will give them suggested language that has the approval of the Conservation Commission. And we intend to use the language that they provided us for the floating easement.
But
now that
to
great,
show it on the plan too. Yes.
Okay. Well, the floating easement, we have marked the plan indicating that there is a floating easement over that open space,
mm-hmm.
and that's included in our submissions relating to our dealings with the Conservation Commission. But it's up to the Conservation Commission at some future date to determine exactly where the green belt is going. They have.
Mm-hmm.
They'll have the whole of that open mm-hmm. space on which to set out their greenbelt path.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be some things they'll try to get as close to the easterly boundary as possible, that type of thing. But they will ultimately determine where the path will go, as I understand what they've shown me.
Good. On number 11, the contour lines we need for the wetlands particularly, we will want to have probably, I would imagine this board will want 1 foot contours, and we'll need to describe the vegetation.
We do provide 1 foot contours.
For the wetlands.
Yes. May I ask a question?
Yes.
We did receive a checklist from Steve Butler at the previous meeting. And as I go through this, this looks like the one we had, and I believe like most of these items may have been addressed as I quickly go through this.
Well, this is subsequent to our workshop.
Okay.
I think you were at that workshop.
Yes.
Yes, and this is a checklist that is
okay.
drafted since then. And unfortunately, our planner is in the far, far east, so...
Would I speak to him in terms of...
But I think you should,
okay.
yes, talk with him about that. The surface drainage plan and stormwater management plan, you'll know, is under review by our town engineer, but he needs to see the whole scheme of things, and it might be helpful for you. He can't review these plans as they are now, and he needs a much better description of the roads, of the drainage, and so if you can perhaps talk with him to see how better you can define that for him, it would be helpful.
We filed watershed maps.
Pardon?
Was he in terms of watershed maps, or was it, because we supplied
the ones that were supplied after the packet went out?
Well, all the figures.
From Owen Haskell.
But those were circulated. Mr. Hunter was away. We brought the stuff to his office. I forgot. But those were...
Those the ones you gave me at the meeting
that's
downstairs.
Right,
okay,
yes.
We got some others after that, which did not go out to the board members that came in. And I don't know who those... Those came through Owen Haskell's office, I believe.
Okay, I just am not aware of that. Mm-hmm.
Just to explain, our board needs... to allow at least 15 to 18 days, 18 days really, for the town engineer to look at the plans and then give some feedback to the planning board before we all meet, so that that's, so the timing is what is very important here in getting us together.
Okay, I'm mystified by that. I thought that our application was in order. The watershed maps were filed the Monday following, but all of the calculations and all the figures were in the filing that was made on...
18 days before.
Yes, it was made on the 29th, and the watershed maps are really in aid of the engineer's mm-hmm. study of the
calculations.
Of the calculations, and those... Mr. Hunter had been away from the previous Wednesday
right.
until the following Friday, but we,
yes.
you know, those things were placed with his materials just following the workshop.
Mm-hmm.
And there's something else that has come in since that. That's, we can find out about that now.
Okay, what happened with one of the plans being put out in darkness?
Those, I thought 500 was in the building.
Running out.
No.
Right, okay.
So we are not in receipt yet of the engineer's review, or is the board in receipt, I guess, of these?
They came in after one.
Because they came in after the...
If I could just clarify something, those
yes.
plans there, what happened was when we sent the plans out for printing, they weren't dark enough, and after the workshop, when we reviewed the plans to aid the planning board, we submitted those plans which showed the wetlands area darker on the plans.
You have those plans.
They're already incorporated in the set. They just didn't print out as dark as they probably should have.
So I wouldn't want our application to be in deficient because of those. Those are just a better copy of what you had before you.
Okay. Let's just move along to any other. There is no landscaping plan that you've submitted. I think, are there some other questions or notations or comments by, yes, Mrs. Guthrie?
Madam Chairman, just as a point of information, back to the septic systems again. According to sheet number 7 of the 19 sheets you recently submitted, the new set of sheets.
Yes.
Am I correct in my interpretation of your plan? I see no septic system for lots 27, 11, 10, 32, 31, 25, and 23. And I won't even mention the 6 lots that are waiting for the elusive sewer. Am I correct in my reading of that?
The lots 11, 10, 31, 32, 25, and 27 are being serviced by the community septic systems.
Yes. Now, I see a community septic system up at the top.
Yes.
And now, are these all going to flow into lots 38 and 36 all that way?
Okay, lots 25 and 27 will be serviced by the community septic system on the top of the plan.
25
and 27.
27.
There's a 30-foot sanitary sewer easement shown behind lots 25 and 27.
Yeah.
Those two lots will be serviced by that system.
I see. And that is going to be owned by the association?
That yes,
land,
that's...
Okay.
Yes, that's open space land.
Okay.
And lots 10, 11, 31, and 32.
10, 11, 31, and 32.
Well, the sewage from the septic tank will pass through the 30-foot sanitary sewer easement that's shown behind those lots down to where two lots, 10, 11, will be serviced by the community septic system shown on proposed lot 38. And lots 31 and 32 will be serviced by the community system on lot, proposed lot 36.
So then you're telling me that 27, 11, 10, 32, 31, 25, and 23 have no, the soils are so fragile on those 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
but the,
7 lots. That,
excuse me, lot 23 does have a leach field. It's shown up to the upper left-hand corner of the house.
It. Okay. I'm sorry, I'll cross that off my list. So all the 6 lots then cannot accommodate septic systems or leach fields.
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Gross.
I too had a lot of trouble following the contour and the flow data for the watershed area, and I agree with Alice on that problem. Again, back on the sewers, for lots 36 and 38, you show on the soils map in the southern part of the development 2 areas of Dixfield soil. I'm assuming that where the septic systems are going to be are on those 2 areas.
Yes.
And they are surrounded by Swanton and Colonial Beach, poorly, somewhat poorly drained soils, correct?
Yes.
And then for the community septic system out in the open space, I take it that is going to go into the Lyman Tunbridge formation up there?
If I could direct these questions to Elmer Frick.
Oh, okay.
He knows better than myself on the soil.
Have for 36 and 38 down in the Dixfield, the 2 areas where the Dixfield soils are, and then for the other community septic system, I'm assuming that it doesn't show on the map anywhere, but it goes up into the Lyman Tunbridge formation?
That's correct.
And both of these 2 areas are surrounded with the one at the top with the Lyman Tunbridge is surrounded by the Whateley B and the Swanton soils. Again, poor soils, poor septic systems?
That's correct, yes.
I don't really feel comfortable with the amount of information that we have before us to judge on a community septic system. There isn't any flow data on how much these systems are going to produce. We don't know how large the Dixfield areas are, and given that they're surrounded by very poorly drained soil, I'm not comfortable with the amount of information that we have for these two areas.
Okay, the area of the Dixfield is delineated on the soil map, 1 inch to 100, so that would show the extent of the various type of soils. The amount of sewage, wastewater that are going into each of these community systems are shown on the HHE 200 form applications that you received as part of the application. Each community system will receive 2 dwelling units, and it's proposed to be 4 bedroom units, equating to 360 gallons per unit. So there'll be 720 gallons going into each community system.
Okay.
So it's not a massive amount of water, it's just from 2 units.
But again, from the soils map that we have, it is seeing a surface picture of the property and trying to determine if those 2 relatively small areas surrounded by very, very poor soils can support the 2 houses per area, and at the same time be in what is the general flow of the surface water out of the area.
Okay. All the community systems are sited on upland positions, knolls that do not have surface water draining upon them. They're all positive drain areas. That's why they were selected. The state of Maine subsurface wastewater disposal rules require that that sufficient area be delineated for a disposal system, and that is determined by the hydraulic capacity of the soil. Dixfield, Lyman, Tunbridge all have various ratings, and sufficient spatial area to handle 720 gallons per day does have to be delineated, and is delineated on the applications that were submitted as a package. Those soils, Dixfield, Lyman, and Tunbridge, require 1.7 square feet of land area for every gallon per day of sewage that it's accepting. And that's defined by the Maine regulations, subsurface wastewater disposal rules.
Okay. Now for the other community system, that is also a rock outcrop. Okay.
It's shown as a Lyman-Tunbridge rock outcrop. That's the area where it's positioned. What that means, Lyman soil is areas where the bedrock ranges from 24 inches and less. Tunbridge soil is defined as shallow to bedrock glacial till soil where the bedrock is less than 40 inches but greater than 24 inches. And there's also some rock outcropping in that area, so it's mapped as Lyman Tunbridge rock outcrop, the most predominant type, Lyman being first, Tunbridge being second, and rock outcrop being the least predominant.
So in that area, the most predominant type of soil is a soil with a depth of less than, was it 24 inches?
Ranging in 24 inches, correct. The state of Maine subsurface wastewater disposal rules requires for a site to be acceptable that you have a minimum of 15 inches of suitable soil below the organic layer to the bedrock, okay, throughout the entire area of the proposed leach field. All these sites exceed 15 inches to bedrock. it goes on further to require that the bottom of the disposal system will have to be elevated a minimum of 2 feet above the bedrock to assure environmental sanitation. So these sites will require site modification. They are suitable, but they have to be enhanced by bringing in fill to increase the separation distance to meet the factors.
Any other questions? Mr. Mills?
Yeah, I just noticed on this floor map, do you know the investment that we just a little bit of an idea of these test locations that were right
on? Yes, they are.
Okay. Yes.
Just to look like, are they ground cold like test pit or are they actually a backhoe?
No, these were all excavated with a backhoe. And then further on, because the Cape Elizabeth ordinance requires a minimum of 5 test pits in the proposed disposal area, there's a minimum of 1 and most of them 2 backhoe test pits in every proposed disposal area site. And then each corner was bored with an auger to assure that the ledge is satisfactory.
Is there any requirement, or was there any attempt to do anything about mapping the aquifer?
No, that there wasn't. But typically, the soils that are mapped, shallow bedrock, glacial till, and the Swanton scantic soils, marine clays, they're not typically recognized as a sand and gravel aquifer. Mm-hmm. If you do have aquifer, it would be bedrock aquifer. Mm-hmm.
other questions?
Mr. Tinsman, at the workshop or at the last meeting, raised the question of test pits along the boundary line with the town of Cape Elizabeth at the transfer station.
Yes.
Concerning leachates from the town landfill, has that been addressed?
Yeah, we're undergoing a study at this time.
Other questions? It is my thought that we perhaps should waive our usual order of things and consider going on a site walk to look at this large, delicate piece of property. And even though we may not determine that your application is complete tonight, and I just wondered what the other board members felt about that, if they would be willing to do that.
Madam Chairman, could you, for me, review, maybe for the audience as well, the provisions for what we mean by completed application, and also where you feel that we don't have a completed application?
Our town planner, in conjunction with the town engineer and legal counsel and the planning board, draw up a list, or there is an appendix to our ordinance which indicates what materials should be brought in to make an application complete. And in doing the review process, we determine the application is complete, then we usually go on a site walk, and then we do we have 30 days to kick in from there for a public hearing, and we're off and running. As regards this application completeness, I think that we are still missing some information on water mains and culverts and landscape plans and the items that you have which are either partial or starred here in the list that was given to you today. I think that we need to have some dialogue with Mr. Malley to be more familiar with the sewer ordinance before we start sketching in lots that you would like ultimately to hook up to a town sewer. And so these are, this is the process that we go through. And does that touch on...
As I understand the process, there's a first vote of the planning board whether the application is sufficiently put together to constitute a basis of decision. And data has to be prepared and available to the planning board to review. Once that's done, for the board to review the sufficiency of that data. And a lot of the questions that we've had about are really about the sufficiency of the data. Whether it's appropriately done, whether the lots are appropriately subdivided, whether the form and substance of the subdivision is appropriate for approval, or whether we would disapprove the subdivision. What you've indicated, and I guess I still don't know as one board member why the water mains portion isn't, I see the word partial and I heard some of the discussion, but are we saying that that is insufficient to constitute a completed application?
One of some other things.
And why? The water mains not all shown on the plan?
Right, and they don't show where they're going to and where they're going from, and that's...
So they don't tie together?
Tie in, and so that they can be viewed as one separate.
Okay, and yet I heard the applicant say, but they do, and we thought the continuation sheet showed that so that they tie together. Our position would be that if we don't determine the application sufficient, that we may have two water mains coming somewhere and they don't match, mm-hmm. and therefore it's not an application complete mm-hmm. enough for us to look at. Is that what we're saying?
That's part of it.
Okay. Landscaping plans are required if landscaping is proposed, but if there's no landscaping proposed, then the application is complete. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, the distinction in drawing, Dick, is that we may not like the plans, but
that's correct.
Mm-hmm.
That's correct. If the data missing, clearly missing from that required, then the application is not complete. If it's wrong, or we don't like it, that doesn't mean it's not complete.
Correct.
That's a later decision that we have to make. And I guess I'm not convinced yet, after listening to the process that we've just gone through, that we have an incomplete application. We may have a wrong application, or the data may not be appropriate, but the data may or may not be there.
Your position is that you feel there's enough material here to make a judgment, to go ahead and make a decision?
I guess that's what I'm questioning, and I don't see anything on the checklist that would indicate that that isn't the case. And as one board member, I think we have to be careful that we don't evaluate the data before we say it's complete or not. To me, once we say that the application is complete, then we begin the evaluation process. And if it's wrong, then that data has to be resubmitted by an applicant. If we're going to do all the evaluation before we consider it complete, then
no, I think that's correct. We don't do all the evaluation before it's complete. And I think you make a very good point.
I just don't see anything here. I mean, we have data on culverts, we have data on drains. It may not be perfect, mm-hmm. and it may not be acceptable to the board. But we do have data that's submitted by an applicant.
And there are proposed landscaping plans, but we haven't seen them.
We have no landscaping other than what we described to you in a narrative form.
We pointed out on
the
map.
Yes, and trees will be required by the mm-hmm. individual homeowners will be required to position trees in such a way as to screen out various things on the property.
You had a whole row of trees that you were putting between as sort of a buffer between.
That's right. Those are described, and we'll put those in as we go along. Those are shown in this plan under here. But we have no landscape plan as such. This is our plans are to put buffers between, but we haven't determined what kinds of trees will be used, the heights of the tree, you know, that type mm-hmm. of thing. But we do intend to put those buffers where the dark green is shown. But we don't have a landscape plan that would qualify as mm-hmm. a landscape plan, which a landscape architect would mm-hmm. submit. And we're not asking for approval of a landscape plan. It is a subdivision, but we've told you what our landscape intentions are. Now, even up in here, there'll be landscaping done, but not pursuant to a plan.
Well, I think we would need to see that, to have that.
One comment.
This is off the site, you know, this, we dealt, this is something that we, that, okay, if you feel it's incomplete without the plan, this is on town land up here, and we made a, we have an obligation to the town to keep that properly, yes, whatever, you know, to keep the raked and clean or whatever they require. We've spelled it out in our agreement with the town. But we don't have a plan as such that we're submitting in connection with this. We have told you that it's our intention to do this screening to, and what our obligations are up here. But if our application is incomplete without that, but we had not intended to submit a plan by a landscape architect in this connection.
The one point I think that would, on this list, this checkoff list, that I would think would give us cause for concern is the one that's triple asterisk, where the town engineer is telling us he cannot, I'm reading that correctly, under review by our town engineer, and understand what we're hearing here, is he cannot properly give us his evaluation because of the form of the plan. That I would have to consider incomplete.
Now, may I address, I would ask Mr. Levesque to address that. I know that we didn't have quality of water studies, and those are being undertaken now. But I was my own feeling that the surface drainage plan was very elaborately addressed in these. Now, I'll ask Mr. Levesque to comment on that.
I guess I'd like to say is that these storm drainage calculations, both existing and proposed, were submitted to Bob Hunter through the planning board with plans on sufficient time of 15 to 18 days. The only set of plans that were late in terms of his review are the watershed maps, but we hand-delivered those to his office that following Monday after the workshop, I believe, or it was before the workshop.
I believe Mr. Hunter, in all fairness, was on vacation for maybe that week.
Right, he was on vacation the Wednesday too.
But it is my understanding that he's having some difficulty reviewing the plan.
Yeah, we have no problem in terms of meeting with him for review.
Madam Chairman, if I might, and I'm not a proponent of this development, but more a proponent of a process, that if an applicant comes in with a two-page surface drainage plan or stormwater management plan and gives it to us, that's an application completeness issue that we have to say we received it. Sufficient to constitute a basis. Doesn't mean we agree with it, doesn't mean that it's appropriately done, doesn't mean that it in any way means anything other than that plan was submitted to us for review and evaluation. Now, if we determine that it's inaccurate, inadequate, or just inappropriate, then that has got to be a basis for the planning board decision in the evaluation process. I think it should be clear to all applicants that just because we have an application sufficient to constitute a basis of decision, that decision might be disapproval because we don't believe that there's sufficient data there to have us approve that subdivision. And we're doing the same thing again. We're evaluating information to see if we can approve a subdivision based on the plan that was submitted rather than the fact that we just have that data there. Now, the area that I see in this list that is of concern is contours. And we have contours proposed, and it's fully contoured as a development. I don't know why there isn't something in there. And a basis for determining that it's inadequate would be that we prefer and we would require a different contour interval. And I haven't heard that discussion here tonight. So I see a lot of data. I see a lot of issues that are submitted and that we have data on all of these issues, even though it may be partial and it may be inadequate to give approval on. But I'm not sure that we don't have a complete application.
Oh, well, I guess the board should fully discuss this and come to a decision tonight. I think, Dick, that you've touched on a very valid point. I guess my feeling has been that we are shy some materials, and I still see it as a little incomplete. However, I certainly want to hear what other planning board members say.
Mm-hmm. I guess, I don't know. I guess we get a checklist, and if people that we have as staff indicate that something is partial, I think we have to consider at that point whether we're going to overrule them, consider that it's okay, and check it off. What I think it does is it keeps the process going. I don't know whether we can keep the process going tonight anyways, even if this is not accepted as a complete application and still schedule a sidewalk. I don't think I think the problem there is if we schedule a sidewalk, we're now under a time clock to get a hearing done. Yeah, and that's what the problem is.
Mm-hmm.
So we really have to go with what we have, and that's what the basis of the hearing and everything else has to be done. Mm-hmm. So it'd be my tendency to get a better reading from our planner, from our town engineer, as to exactly why partial, why asterisks are there. And if they're not here, my suggestion would be that we go ahead with the sidewalk, but delay the declaration on the completeness of the application.
It would be possible to determine that the application is complete at the next meeting and then go ahead with review.
I think, though, that our ordinance does require that we give the reasons for an application not to be complete within mm-hmm. a certain number of days from the receipt being right. given by the planning board. And, I mean, if you say that the drains portion is incomplete because it's only partially there, then that presumes that we know where the drains should be, or that we've done an evaluation process and that they're only showing 50% of the drains, or they're not connecting with something. But there's got to be a reason why something is incomplete, and we've got to write it down and give that to an applicant.
All right.
Well, would the suggestion then be that this checkoff list be condensed down to just the incomplete items, and that list now be forwarded to the applicant, items that are incomplete, why?
We're required to do that by ordinance. So it's an appropriate suggestion.
Marion or Bernie,
well,
do you want to comment?
This is again another highly controversial subject. But under checklist number 14, surface drainage plan or stormwater management plan, there are three little asterisks which mean under review by the town engineer. Although that is under review by the town engineer, obviously something has been submitted in that regard. So I would have to agree with Dick. I think we should keep this process rolling along, and I have seen a great deal of information, you know, on this, and if some contour lines are partial, we still have something. That indicates, the word partial indicates that something was submitted.
I would agree with Mr. Kinsman. I'd like to see the process move along.
I guess we're at a matter of a vote, our consensus here. I guess I would ask the planning board to make a motion, or I would entertain a motion that the application be determined complete or incomplete.
Madam Chairman, before I make that motion, and I will make that motion, I think it's important also to indicate to all applicants, particularly this applicant, that kind of motion and action, if it was approved by the planning board, doesn't mean that there won't be additional data that's required by the planning board, because there are questions about the adequacy of certain of that information. I think that should be clear in all instances. And with that, I would move that the planning board, finds the application for Gullcrest Farms to be complete, sufficient for review and action, review by the board.
Is there a second?
I second it.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there some discussion?
I don't think we have to add it as a I'm not going to suggest a change to the motion. I'm just wondering if we can, in some fashion, direct the applicant to our requirement, or direct to the applicant the list of items that would be deemed incomplete, as I suggested, in addition to accepting it, accept it with a letter indicating what would be. And if we can so have our planner.
I think that would be appropriate. Any other discussion? I would just remind the board and the applicant that this does start the clock running. If we determine the application to be complete, we set the site walk visit, and then we are in serious review and evaluation, and we go forward at the public hearing, and we must be ready to answer all questions from the public in regards to all the technical data that is being submitted. With that, I'm ready for the motion. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Opposed? The motion is 4-1. So we are determining that your application is complete. We would like to send you a delineation of some of these things that we feel perhaps should be rounded out before the next session, and I think it would be helpful for you to address those. What would be your time frame for a site walk?
First, I'd like to just comment briefly that we are very sensitive to the board's needs and requirements on all of this. As you know, we are undertaking these other studies as supplemental studies, as they were described last time at the workshop, and we will be very sensitive to anything that you suggest, obviously, and we don't want to do anything to discourage suggestions as to what might improve our application. Now, we're at your disposal on the site walk, I'm sure that...
Madam Chairman, would it be possible to schedule that site walk as a prelude to our workshop meeting?
Which would be the 7th of June. It's a very large site.
Yes, it's a great
deal. And I think you might need, as much as 2 hours to go over it?
I think so. It's a nice day. You take it all the time in the world, but it would take a couple of hours to...
I wonder if... I think it might be better to see it on a Saturday or Sunday or perhaps another time, unfortunately. How about Sunday, Saturday the 4th? Is Sunday, how about Saturday the 28th? I'm getting negative
for me
either. I don't want to discourage anybody by saying it would take 2 hours. I was thinking of the last one we did, and the Conservation Commission took us through swamps and trees, and we went all over, and maybe...
Well, how large is this?
I would think that an hour...
100 what?
112. Yeah, but we're not going to have to view the areas that's being set aside. Our prime interest would be the area that's going to develop.
I would say that we could well within an hour take you over. We have the roads all laid out, the lots laid out with stakes. I would say an hour for that. I was thinking more of this, of the excursion.
Well, I'll come back to my suggestion that we keep it on the same day we've already set.
I think that's a good idea. Saturdays are precious in June and July.
I'm going to propose that we try it at 5 o'clock on Tuesday the 7th.
Do you want to make that 4:30 to just give us a little breather? Is that difficult?
That could be difficult. I was looking for the other way, 5:30. Okay. If our workshop starts at 7:30...
We have it scheduled for 7, don't we?
No, 7:30 for workshops.
7, yeah. I thought we had.
7. That's right, we thought the meeting started at 7:30.
Well, it was published in the paper.
We'll just have a picnic at the farm.
Not sponsored by the...
Well, all right, let's try 5 o'clock then and see what we can do with that. And
June 7th.
June 7th, 5
o'clock. On June 7th, is that appropriate for the rest of your team? And everyone here can make that. Good. We'll see you on a beautiful sunny afternoon.
We'll try to arrange for that.
Will we have directions where the meeting park and all that?
Well, what we have done before is we've met at the Spurwink Avenue entrance to the property. And we don't want to get in the habit of locating this in this way, but it's down from the church about a mile and a half. No, it's just beyond the road to the transfer station on the left-hand side.
You will have it flagged for us where the lots are going to be and...
Yes, the lots are...
And where the septic...
Well, Roland has those on the, we'll bring the maps that will show, or oh, certainly the community septic,
the test
pits. Pits and all that, yes, we will have all that. I suggest that you park your cars just on the road, the driveway leading into the property. There's plenty of room off the side of the road to put automobiles, and we can all walk in together from there.
We have a
did we get you one of this from last week? Information
Have you
received?
Had a dated receipt?
I'm sorry, I can't.
Dated receipt?
I don't think we have.
Think so. Okay.
Thank you very much. And we'll see you on the 7th.
Thank you. Yes, thank you.
But there are things we'll need to ask for. Item of business is Elizabeth Farms coming in for the signing of a final plan and a revision of a letter of credit. Mr. Weinschenk.
Good evening.
Good evening. We have received no letter of credit or anything from our town lawyer or town manager.
We have not submitted a letter of credit yet. The last time that we got to this stage with the subdivision, we had a letter of credit. And then it was revised at the last minute. We had to go back and get another one. We had submitted to Bob Hunter the estimate for the work, which was $60,000, and then heard this afternoon that he wanted to add something in the order of 5% or something to that. So, additionally, as we're getting quite a bit of the work done in the coal field section and are looking a year later to reduce the existing letter of credit by the amount of work that we have done, we're finding some confusion as to that process and would like to have the letter of credit amount set this evening and have this revised subdivision conditioned on submitting that, especially because we won't be really getting to any of these lots until late this fall or early in the spring, and don't want to have the letter of credit sitting there chewing up the clock at 1%, if you know what I mean. If you don't have a problem with that, that's what we would like to do.
Well, we have an ordinance that requires approval by our town lawyer and our town manager, and so we need all of that before we can attend to a letter of credit, a revised letter of credit.
I guess I don't understand what it is that you need before you can establish the amount. That's the first thing I need to get the letter credit is for you.
We need Mr. Hunter's, a letter from Mr. Hunter saying that that is an amount that he approves.
Okay, I guess I need that letter too.
Yes. We all need that.
Okay.
So if you will bring us that, then we can move forward on that.
All right. Once I bring that amount, I still would like to postpone, if you will, the actual issuing of the letter of credit until such time that I'm ready to begin to do the work. I will not probably do it for 6 months or so. The letters of credit are issued on an annual basis. So that if I didn't have to hand you that letter for those first 6 months, then I would save 6 months worth of that letter, if you know what I mean.
Well, okay, yes.
Is this confusing enough?
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure we can render that kind of request, really. I think that's something that we really have to get an opinion from our legal counsel on. I don't see where this planning board can really address that issue.
I don't think we can do anything for you tonight until you get the letter of credit from Mr. Hunter, and then we go through the process of having it approved by all the appropriate town bodies. It may be that we can delay your actual work. I don't know, but we will have to look into that request. We have not, we did not know that that was what you were here for.
Okay. Mr. Hunter told me, my office on the telephone today, that the amount that he was going to recommend to the board was $63,000. And I guess he spoke to you.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the amount that I should be trying to get a letter from him?
I think that sounds appropriate.
Okay.
He feels it is, because he's much more familiar with the cost of the construction of it's mainly the additional septic.
That's all it is. The leach system for those six lots.
Yes.
Right.
So if you get that documentation, then that will speed that process along.
Okay.
Thank you very much. It has been moved and seconded that we table this particular item. All those in any discussion? Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
And opposed? Motion is carried. The next item under new business is Kathleen Violette, a daycare proposal at 6 Elmwood Road.
Hi.
Hello.
I don't really understand too much why I'm here, except
that
I need the fence.
If you could just identify yourself then and explain what it is you want to do, and we have a little information. We know that you have been to the zoning board of appeals and for conditional use, so we need to know perhaps what happened there, and if you can tell us what you would like to propose.
Okay, I'm Kathy Violette. And we went to the zoning board for a variance in the zoning, and that was approved. What I need from you, I guess, is I have to erect a fence. And they've already told me it has to be 8-foot stockade. And I showed them where. And I need to put in some buffers. and shrubs.
What you are here before us is because of a site plan review for an application like this. We look at such things as lighting, traffic, health, and safety,
mm-hmm.
and to determine whether this is a safe and helpful operation, and whether it has any impact, undue impact on abutters or neighbors, and things of that nature. So we are interested in how you would buffer your operation from your neighbors. As I understand, are you in a duplex?
Duplex.
House?
Mm-hmm.
And the other people live there as residents and they don't have any business?
No, they don't.
Are there questions of board members?
Mrs. Violet, are you going to erect the fence around the whole perimeter of the duplex?
No, on my half only.
Just on your half?
Mm-hmm.
And you, as I understand from what I read, are not the owner of this duplex?
No.
It is owned by one Mr. and Mrs.
Ms. Orion.
Thank you, Ms. Orion.
Yeah.
This raises a legal question in my mind, whether conditional variances or whatever can be granted without the owner's permission. This has come up before us before. Mm-hmm. And if we mandate that you should erect this 6-foot fence, etc., and some owner isn't aware of this, this could be a problem, I think, for the town. I'm not an attorney, but I'm interested in legal issues. So that raises a question in my mind, whether we can go through a site plan review without the owner present. And I think our town attorney might have to give us some advice on that.
Marion, there may be an easy answer if you do have approval of the owner of the house.
Yes, I do.
If we had something for our record that indicated that the owner approves, I'm not sure we have a problem.
He was at the zoning meeting and spoke.
Excuse me, could we go through the chair when you have comments so that we're not getting mixed signals? Is the secretary to the zoning board, so she may be able to shed some light.
Yes, I was at that meeting, and the owner was there, and he did approve of it being in his building, so there was no question. He knows about it. And
mm-hmm. Well, that's what the record states, but shouldn't we have such a thing in writing for the benefit of the town?
I brought it.
Yes, I think that would be very helpful. I'm sorry, Mr. Boxer, what was your comment?
No, I wasn't trying to cut Marion off. I just, I think your legal objection was a valid one. There has to be some right title or interest to seek the application. And if she has that, then we probably can get to the next step. I was wondering whether there was any opposition to your project and whether you've talked to all the neighbors.
There was some opposition from Mrs. Darling, 21 Forest Road, she spoke, and Mr. Flaherty on the other side of the duplex on Elmwood Avenue, and I believe it's 2 Elmwood Road. That was the only opposition that I was aware of, and I brought letters from the rest of my neighbors, immediate neighbors.
Madam Chair.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Just one more question, Mrs. Violet. How much room is there between your duplex and the house next door and the house behind you? Very difficult from this little blue thing that was submitted for me to figure out. Is it 40 feet total of the two houses, meaning that the duplex is 40 feet long or the lot. It was hard for me to tell.
Okay. Where are you looking?
I'm looking on the little blue sheet. The little blue plan that you submitted. Property, et cetera, is written down on the bottom, Elmwood Road. Exactly how much room is there?
Okay, that's 40 feet total of the two duplexes together. On the front, you'll notice I broke it up. It's 20 and 20.
Yes, so they're 20, each building is 20 feet long.
Right.
That's not the land.
No.
No.
The total of the land is what you want to know from...
Yes, what is the size of the lot on which that duplex sits? And then we'll go on from there and try to figure out how far is that house from the houses surrounding it.
Okay. From the other side of the duplex, it's 22 feet to the property line, to Elmwood Road.
22 feet.
To the property line.
Property line.
Mm-hmm. And on my side, it's just about the same. We're talking 22 feet on each side to each house, to each property line.
It says 50 feet. It says 50 feet to 8 Elmwood.
No, if you go down from there, it says 11 foot 1 inch, which appears to be from the side of the house to the end of the driveway property. Then in the back, houses to property line 33 feet, so it's about 11, about 33 feet width in the back. The length of the back, you can't determine.
Very difficult to...
What's this? Oh, edge of the pole.
How many children do you plan to have there at one time?
8 is all the town would allow me. I was state licensed for 12, but 8 is what the town limited me to at one time.
And they will have outdoor activities as well as indoor activities?
Mm-hmm. With a stipulation that they weren't allowed out until 9:30 in the morning. And they're all gone by 5:30, and there's no weekends.
Yes, Mr. Cross.
The fence that you're proposing to build, it'll enclose the yard where the children will be, so there won't be any problem with them getting out on the street or anything like that.
That's correct.
And it'll only enclose your half of the total yard.
Yes.
And people will drop the children off where, and how do they enter
okay.
the premises?
I'm not good on Southwest. In the letter I got, they will travel down Cottage Farms Road, take a left onto Maplewood, and take a left onto Elmwood and drop them off in front of my house at 6 Elmwood, on the right-hand side of the street.
At the front door?
Mm-hmm.
So they would go directly into the house?
Right.
Alice?
Yes.
We're in an interesting position here, and I suppose in theory we're in the same position with any application that's a permitted use, but this application has received a conditional use approval from the Zoning Board of Appeals. Having asked my question about opposition, I refreshed myself by looking through the material we got, and I saw that there was some, but at the same time I refreshed my recollection of what the Zoning Board of Appeals did. And in granting a conditional use permit, they, according to the minutes of the Zoning Board of Appeals meeting, went through the criteria of two separate sections of Chapter 19 of the ordinances, which cover almost identical criteria to ours. I don't know if all the board members have had a chance to compare the criteria, but they talk about impact on neighborhood and buffering uses and attractiveness. And I guess that, in my mind, raised a question as to how deeply we ought to get into those same criteria and make a judgment, sort of a de novo judgment as to whether it's in the best interest of the neighborhood or compatible with the surrounding uses, or whether we can't simply get right to the, I think the criteria that at least to me are important, the protection for surrounding uses and making sure that we're not adversely affecting any surrounding uses, and with the conditions imposed by the Zoning Board of Appeals, we've got a little bit of a limit on what we do without creating a procedural mess here. If we want a 9-foot fence in a different direction and your approval is based upon a 6-foot fence in another part of the yard, then we can keep bouncing you back and forth like a ping pong ball. My reaction is, having seen what the Zoning Board of Appeals went through to approve this, and having seen the conditions that they opposed, that they imposed on it, I'm comfortable that those conditions are going to be protective of all the criteria of our ordinances, and just in the interest of treating a minor matter as a minor matter, I'd be prepared to give some considerable deference to what they did.
Thoughts or comments on that? Oh dear. Mr. Cross.
According to the ordinance in section 19-3-14F, 20% of the household can be used for the home occupation. And this is a question to the board, basically. On her plan, she shows the entire first floor being used for this purpose, and I'm wondering how the interpretation works there. My other concern is we're talking 8 children, 16 trips, plus 3 stated trips that will be taken with the children in the van, a total of 22 trips a day that this one house will generate, and that impact on that neighborhood. It's around 12 more, if I remember my traffic studies correctly, around 12 more than the average household generates.
Mary?
Just to explain to Greg that we have had this situation come before us before, and the problem is that the daycare facilities are not considered home businesses, and that's why Mrs. Violette could utilize the entire ground floor of her home, and that's why she's here before us, because now we must do a site plan review. If it were a home business, we wouldn't have even been involved in this. But Mrs. Violette, one more question. Mm-hmm. On the other side of the duplex, mm-hmm. does the gentleman who lives there own that, or is this entire duplex owned by the one?
Ms. O'Ann.
I see. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? We do have some members of the public here, and this is not a public hearing, but if you want to speak briefly, that would be all right. If you would come forward and just state your name and where you live, please.
Good evening. I'm Dorothy Klein. I live at 28 Forest Road, which is a street that runs parallel to Elmwood. I believe that the community opposition was somewhat understated. I know that my husband and I had written a letter, and the lady that lives right up the street from me had gathered quite a few of them together, was my understanding, when it was presented to the zoning board. Now, from what I understand, Mr. Boxer's standpoint is that they already went over the health and safety issues, and that's not what you're here to do tonight. What I'd like to know is, what are you reviewing, and how can we rebut to that? Well, under the ordinance, that the zoning ordinance, we have a site plan review that we should be considering, and that's under on page 1913. It's section 19-2-9, and it goes into details of what the building size is, and the location of all the buildings around it, the dimensions, the driveways, the parking areas, the building setbacks, the physical features of the site, which is really pertinent, parking, loading and unloading areas, traffic patterns would be pertinent. Landscaping and buffering is within our
your jurisdiction
purview
at this time.
Yes, these sorts of things. Well, lighting.
Yes, I believe from what I understood, the information that she just gave, that the side of the house is only 22 feet to the other property. Now, in the back area, she has what, 32 feet, did you say?
Really very and difficult to tell.
It looks like 33 feet from the house to the property line, the rear of the property line.
If any of you have been through the neighborhood, the houses are extremely close together. They're 22 feet is, of course, less than a garage width. When you're considering putting up a stockade fence and then any sort of buffer, I would think that those trees and so forth that would have to be in there as a buffer would be at least 3 to 4 feet in width, which would again cut down on the available space for these children. There is, as far as the traffic patterns and so forth, it's a nice sort of circular layout that she's given going past her house. However, in that neighborhood, there are no stop signs. During the, I know several times I've had close calls at that particular corner, and the lighting, from what I recall, there's a traffic light perhaps at the end of her street, however it is on Birchwood rather than on Elmwood. There's not a lot of lighting down in that neighborhood either. And I feel that the traffic impact is something that should have been considered, and if it's possible to reconsider it, why do it at this time?
Thank you.
Do you mean a traffic light or a street light?
A street light, excuse me, yes. And no stop signs. Thank you.
Before you go, I didn't mean in any way to not to say that we don't have our own jurisdiction.
Good.
On the other hand, when a fellow board has gone through criteria which are almost identical,
certainly
sensitive. We don't want to revisit that unless we have to. Mm-hmm. So while you're up, I would ask you, if you could give us some specifics on what you would view as a traffic problem as a result of this daycare center.
She is, maybe one at a time.
I'm going to ask everybody the same question, so if you...
If you've got the data on that, I...
You defer to him,
yes,
wherever
I defer.
He is.
Yes, I defer. Thank you.
My name's Jim Harmon. I'm at 23 Cottage Farms Road, and I was not around for the first hearing. There was some confusion as to whether there was a meeting or not. I think there was a snowstorm. I wanted to go over the traffic issue with you. I put together some information. I have the actual pictures here, which I will leave with you afterwards, the photograph that you have in there will probably not do justice to it. If you want me to do it from here, it's probably easier. Basically, what we have is on this is the area that's involved here.
Maybe if you can.
can just use the microphone, that would help, and just point on the map, if you would, or describe the road.
Okay, on the first map, it's just a showing the area that's involved here. I put in yellow the cottage farms, Elmwood Road, and so forth. On the second sheet, I just blew up the area, and it shows my understanding of how the cars are supposed to come in and out with the children. And you can see Shore Road and Woodland. Now, we have a problem in the neighborhood now, and it continues to be a problem, because Cottage Farms is used as a crossover for a number of cars coming and going. It's posted at 25, but I think the average is closer to 40. If you check with the local police department, you'd probably find considerable amount of complaints from the neighbors of speeding up and down the street. So it's a long stretch. They come down and they make a right-hand turn on Maplewood and go into the site. The other way, they come down and make a left-hand. Now, I've circled an area which is a school bus stop, which is presently there in the area. It's been there for a number of years, and that's where the children stand. If you look at this little map here, all I did was show this the area. Okay, and then the site. Now, the pictures aren't going to do justice. I'll give you the originals, but picture number one, I was in my car on Cottage Farms Road. And if you look on the map, it says Crest of the Hill. See picture one? You can't quite see in yours, I'm sure, but if you're sitting in the car, you can't see the children waiting for the bus. You're just starting to crest on the hill, and you go down into a valley. The second picture shows the children standing there. And the third picture, I'll show you this later here. This is picture number one. And then as you move from this point here, all of a sudden they appear down over this crest. This was in the car this morning on Cottage Farms, and you see the pole. Mm-hmm. When you arrive, you see how they run. They're right there. Okay. Mm-hmm. The picture number four, it shows the home where the lady is going to have the children, and you can see the congestion. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8 cars. They're all heading in different directions, and that's at 7:45.
Is that taken recently?
This was all this morning. I did this morning.
Those are cars stopped in front of the
The site, home? Yes.
Presumably letting off children?
Yes. Maybe there's one or two in the neighborhood, but these were cars coming and going. At 7:50, you can see the school buses stopping to pick up the children. And then on Cottage Farms Road, which is right where the turn that they come down to make that turn that we showed you on the map. And then the last picture is just, it gives you another perspective of that knoll. Now, the concern that we have is, number one, the children, and I have a daughter that is out there in the morning. We have a problem with traffic now, and you know, we always have a concern that they're coming and going down there too fast, but now we're adding 10 more cars coming in at the same time that the bus comes, in that 15-minute period, coming and turning into the area where they're standing. Now, as I say, it's 75 feet from this crest dropping down. Now, I had a son that I took to a daycare center, and occasionally you're running a little late and whatever, and you're anxious and you got to drop them off. So, you know, we don't want anybody not to have a problem, but we just have a concern that they're going to be coming down the street a little too fast, take a right-hand turn. In the summertime, especially when they open the rec center and the bus comes, there's more and more younger children. and they're all playing around that area.
Excuse me, are there any other daycare centers in the area, in the neighborhood?
There is one on Shore Road, which is across, mm-hmm. but they don't have to come into our neighborhood to get to it. And then the other one would be off Mitchell, which is Ledgmere. So I leave these pictures with you. The reason I did this is so that I think there's just more study that needs to be done. I mean, I would like to have somebody, sit there and count cars and try to understand. I think it's a substantial impact. We're adding, I counted an average of 8 cars that would normally go by that particular area over a period of a week. 10 more cars, that's 125% increase in that time span, putting them into the area. So I'll leave this with you because they're easy to make.
Madam Chair.
Yes, Mrs.
Sir,
Guthrie.
Sir, before you leave,
question.
Has anyone in your area ever done a house-to-house study on the numbers of small children? Because I don't live very far from your area. I love that area and have had various friends there from time to time or have had to go there. And I have been overwhelmed by the numbers of small children who play outdoors there on little bicycles. And I can remember really slowing down and being concerned that one of them would shoot out from one of the curves, and come into the path of my car. So I think before the next time, I think it would be an interesting thing to find out how many small children are roaming around that area. Maybe it's changed in a few years, but it seems like vast numbers.
The particular street that on Elmwood, there is quite a few children on that street. There's a number of them. I don't know the exact number. On Cottage Farms, where we are in our little area, when you say little children, maybe now they're, my 12-year-olds and 10-year-olds, but there are some, yes.
And I thought that in the Mountain View and Ocean View area, I've always seen lots of little kids on bikes there.
The one advantage to being in that area is that the children can get on their bikes and go to the cookie jar, go to some of the things around the area. So that's why we like it there. And Cottage Farms Road is a problem. We have a problem with traffic. They speed up and down the road. It's a big, wide avenue. It's 750 feet just from the woodland to where you turn on Maplewood, and you can't help. I mean, they get a 40 miles an hour. It takes time to react.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Was there someone else? Yes.
Just getting the copies back.
Yes.
You get the original, so you have to give me your copy.
Mm-hmm. I've written
it. Well, you got the original. I'll give you mine if you give me yours.
Hi, my name is Janet Darling, and I live directly behind the duplex that we're talking about. I feel the zoning board made a terrible mistake allowing this to go through. I think it sets a precedent so that anybody with a 2x4 yard could set up a daycare center. And here's somebody who doesn't even own the property. And we're making these conditional rules for somebody who doesn't even own the property. This area in which I live is a congested area. The yards are small. There are many small children riding bikes. My yard happens to be the largest yard, and it's consequently the noise that the daycare generates comes through my yard, and since there are no houses to buffer it, all the neighbors on my street do not want this daycare there for many different reasons, not only for the safety of their children who ride bikes and like to travel around this what has been a safe area in terms of traffic up to this time that the daycare came in. Kids are used to traveling from the Cottage Farms Road to the Elmwood Road, which is parallel to it, and then to Forest Road. This is their play area. My house is 20 feet from my building. The back of my house is 20 feet from where the proposed stockade fence would be. Naturally, you can see how concerned I would be, not only for the value of my property, which I think would decrease the value of my property to have a daycare center so close, but even if an 8-foot fence or stockade were built with shrubs, my house, since it sits high up, I get all the noise in my windows, and in the summer it's unbearable. And I have a permit from the town to tutor learning disabled children in my home, one at a time. And I think this is an appropriate use for this kind of neighborhood. And of course, you can see why that wouldn't set well with me to have a daycare, because these children who are trying to learn to read and write, it's just another frustration. But aside from that fact, there has been great opposition by neighbors. The short notice we found out about this on Thursday, that this was coming before this board, Mr. Flaherty, who's on the other side, one side of the duplex, is out of state. He called me this morning and asked me to speak for him. He could not get a letter to this board, but he's concerned mostly about the traffic and the noise, and he would agree with what the former speaker said. If this goes through, there should be a very substantial stockade fence. It should be heavily shrubbed, not only on the side where the children would be, but I feel there should be some shrubs on the other side as well. I feel that this move to have a daycare center in this neighborhood significantly changes the whole feeling of the neighborhood and environment. And I never entertained the idea to ever have more than one child at a time in my home for my service. But now I'm thinking, if this daycare goes through, why don't I have something like this? And uh-huh. But I don't want to do that to the neighborhood. But my home is not the same anymore with this daycare.
Can I ask you a question? But I'd like to ask Mrs. Violet a question first. From the Zoning Board of Appeal minutes, it looks as though you presently have an operation with 8 children there. And has that been since February of 87 when you moved in? Mm-hmm. And now I guess my question, Mrs. Darling, is are you concerned about what's there now? Has the presence of 8 children since February of 87, which is, I guess, over a year, has that affected you, or are you concerned about growth and expansion?
Well, I understand that she can't have any more than 8, as set forth by the zoning board. So that isn't my concern. I have been troubled by this since the very beginning. I can't even sit out in my patio. My patio is right, one patio is right there. My ground level patio is right where the stockade fence would be.
What's your address?
21 Forest Road. The yard that she's having the daycare in is so small. It's if somebody else rents the other half of the duplex, they would have the use of the other half of the yard. So Mrs. Violette's half of the yard is exactly about 25 feet by 50 feet. If she puts up the stockade fence, and the bushes, that leaves a little spot for 8 children who are all very young and very loud, and I have nothing against children, and their voices are very pleasant to me in the neighborhood, but when you get 8 of them together in one spot, it's very unpleasant at times. And the other place where I spend a lot of time in my home is on my back porch, which has been most very much of a comfort to me. And now, just today, I was out having lunch, and again, the noise. I just don't see this neighborhood as a place for this, and I think it sets a precedent for me going before the board and opening up a little school. You know, so I can't lose either way, really. But I like my home the way it was.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Darrow. Were there any other neighbors that came here to talk specifically to this?
This is from another neighbor.
Thank you.
Have any of the neighbors who spoke talked with the town public safety officials about the traffic considerations? Pardon me?
I talked to the officer Dyer, and he would have to get a requisition to study it as far as coming over and monitoring the area.
They didn't have any statistics on traffic.
He did not have any that he could present.
Madam Chair,
yes.
Wouldn't the burden of proof, unfortunately, have to lie with Mrs. Violette? Since the question was raised, I think I would like to see some sort of traffic study done concerning this. And I would also like to ask you, Mrs. Violette, as just a point of information. You state that you are licensed by the state. Well, when this has occurred before, I took the time to call the state of Maine in regard to licensing. And it seems that a nursery school entails a totally different license from a daycare center. And what are you licensed in? What is your official license?
Well, there are two things for a daycare. One is, I think it's actually like a daycare license. That's good for a year.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's babysitting services mm-hmm. license, which is what I have. And the only difference between the two is that I'm licensed for 2 years. The fire inspectors come in once a year still,
mm-hmm.
but it's not inspected by the state as with the daycare
right.
license.
So, essentially, this is not a daycare center.
It's a daycare home.
A daycare home, mm-hmm. you can call it, with this particular
yes.
license.
As far as I'm concerned, I never really thought about it.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to know more about that too.
Now I do have a sheet at home just showing you the difference between the two, and that is the two greatest differences.
Well, I think perhaps the board needs a number of things here to help us along on this, and one is Mrs. Guthrie mentioned, actually I guess both suggestions came from her, would be some sort of a traffic appraisal of the impact of what this would be and what the traffic patterns are around your daycare home. In addition, I think it would be helpful to have some sort of account of perhaps children under 8 years old who are within in your neighborhood, just so that mm-hmm. we know what we're dealing with for small children.
Under 8?
I don't know. Maybe the board has some other thoughts about that.
I have just one question. It's a little unclear from your drawing and from this map we were just given.
Is your property on the corner of Birchwood and Elmwood?
No.
It's not. Okay, then I want to ask my next question.
In addition, I think it might be well for the planning board individually perhaps to drive by and look at the site and just see where it is proposed and get a viewing of it. I don't think we need to.
Madam Chairman, I've got a couple of questions. I don't know what a traffic study is going to show. I mean, if there are eight children, presumably there could be eight cars coming in and going out. And I'm not sure that's really what we're after. I think what we're after is more concerned public safety. It may be more appropriate to deal with the same topic on a public safety issue by requesting of the police department that an analysis be done to see if there are public safety concerns there rather than how many cars are going in and out.
I would think that might be related to the traffic. As a factor.
I think that, the board can do with it as it wishes. I've done traffic studies, and I'm not sure what I'd do as a consultant talking about eight vehicles going into a road. You've got sight distances, you've got percentage of vehicles, and the impact on the percentage of vehicles that already use the road.
At a very specific point in time, too.
At a very specific point in time. I think the issue is clearly one of public safety, and traffic consultants don't talk about public safety other than sight distances and then from a quantitative standpoint of how far you can see. To me, the issue is school bus, it's raised, school bus stop. It's the issue of congestion in the area. It's issues of over periods of time, as the picture showed, more concerned with whether they have a concern with problems in the area. Offer that as a suggestion. The second point is that, and to follow up on your suggestion, that we drive by individually, is it inappropriate for the planning board to have a site walk for this site plan application where we all meet together to formally look at where the shrubs are supposed to be planted, where the fence is supposed to go up, and those kind of considerations, so we can stand there and all get the same picture at the same time, since we're going to be voting on this presumably at some meeting.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a good idea.
Could I ask a question, Paul, on what Dick said? I think the neighbors have presented a series of questions that at least make me realize that we aren't in a position to do anything tonight. I'd like to ask you, Mrs. Violet, what's happening there right now? When you found out you needed approval from these two boards, have you stopped the activity?
No.
So it's still going on?
Yes.
Secondly, the traffic study issue, I'm concerned about public safety, but I think it's unrealistic to ask someone who's going to have eight kids that they're going to be babysitting for to go hire Jack Murphy to count cars on College Farms Road. I just don't think that's...
I didn't mean of anything that scope.
I think we got to get at the public safety issue, and our public safety people ought to tell us what they think about it. With respect to a sidewalk, the noise issue bothers me because that is one of our criteria in the ordinance, and I don't know whether this point was presented to the Zoning Board of Appeals or not, but obviously if there's constant screaming a few feet from somebody's backyard and a fence isn't or shrubbery isn't going to block that, then we have to seriously consider that. And I don't know how you get at that at a